On the 20th of July, 1969, NASA successfully planted humanity's first footsteps on the moon. More than five decades later, the space agency is struggling to make a return. But how could that be? What exactly is NASA doing wrong? Is the Artemis mission even worth it? Let's find out how the story connects to the Cold War and fact-check whether SpaceX could really make a fool of NASA when it comes to a moon mission. Since humanity began to explore space, only 12 people have been privileged to walk on the moon. Keen to increase this tally, NASA began to plan a return in 2010, but this time with an ambitious plan to promote equality in space and establish a permanent human base on the lunar surface. The mission called Artemis is named after the mythological Greek goddess of the moon and twin sister of Apollo. In all, the Artemis moon landing mission will desire four important components, with the first being the Space Launch System, aka SLS, which will carry the Orion spacecraft until it is hooked to the Lunar Gateway. The Lunar Gateway will be a mini space station orbiting the moon where astronauts can make a brief stop before transferring to the Human Landing System, aka HLS, that will bring them down to the lunar surface. But unlike the International Space Station, the Lunar Gateway will not be permanently occupied. But scientists believe it will serve a key purpose during the missions to the moon and even beyond. Returning to the moon was never going to be easy, but considering that NASA had successfully executed multiple lunar missions in the past, many believe the ambition is at least conceivable. However, critics were quick to point out that the project is nothing but an overhyped money-gulping scheme, with little or no significance to our space exploration efforts. The most vocal criticism of the Artemis mission was hinged on the cost. Initially, NASA estimated that the cost of the first Artemis mission be around $24.5 billion. Currently, just over $40 billion has been spent, underlining the exponential rise in cost projections. Of course, this has drawn criticism from different sections. If we can't do a rocket for $11.5 billion, we ought to close up shop, Senator Bill Nelson said back in 2010. Nowadays, he serves as NASA's administrator and the wranglings aren't as audible as they were some years back. The Florida-based senator wasn't the only lawmaker unhappy with the cost of the Artemis project. Barack Obama, the United States president at the time, was also against the idea of going back to the moon. His argument was based on the fact that we've been there before, and NASA could instead use its budget and energy towards visiting an asteroid and possibly Mars. While these debates were going on, SpaceX, a small startup at the time, was completing the development phase of the Falcon 9 rocket and the Crew Dragon spacecraft. Back then, NASA thought it was wise to invest only $396 million into the SpaceX flying machines, but proceeded to invest a larger portion of its budget into the Artemis program. Congress unequivocally agreed to this plan in 2010, mainly because it didn't want to cancel the jobs and appointments that the Constellation and Space Shuttle program supported. But unfortunately, 12 years down the line, neither the SLS nor the Orion spacecraft has left the ground yet. Meanwhile, the Falcon 9 rocket and Dragon spacecraft that NASA had invested in at about the same time has become the only means for US astronauts to get into space. When NASA promised the American public that the United States was heading back to the moon, it made sure to accompany this huge promise with what looked like a clear plan, at least at first sight. We were told that the SLS was going to be the most powerful rocket in the world, even more powerful than the Saturn V rocket that safely delivered Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin to the lunar surface many years ago. And the features reported in fact sheet confirmed it. NASA stated that the finished product was going to be a few meters taller than the Statue of Liberty, while generating a whopping 8.8 million pounds of thrust. But what they didn't tell the public was that the SLS rocket was going to be powered by the RS-25 engine, the exact same powertrain that was used in the space shuttles. For sure, it could be a cost-saving measure, but considering the importance and complex nature of the mission, one would think that NASA would take a more innovative approach to build a more sophisticated engine to power its most powerful spacecraft ever. On the other hand, even if the decision to use these old engines was taken as a way to save cost, it kind of defeats the purpose because in the end, NASA is seemingly spending way more than it should on the project. To understand this better, NASA initially stated that each Artemis SLS spacecraft that hits the skies will cost $800 million. But recently, audits show the space agency will be spending approximately $4.1 billion per launch. In comparison, the Falcon Heavy spacecraft cost $100 million per launch and can hoist about two-thirds the payload capacity of the SLS. As if that's not bad enough, reports suggest that future Artemis missions will use new RS-25 engines manufactured by Rocket Aerojet Rocketdyne. Each cost $145 million. To do this at a time and age where reusable spacecraft are dominating the skies is almost unthinkable. It's almost as if NASA and Congress have consistently connived to waste public funds. Some commentators believe that there's some element of nepotism in the way the project has been handled. Congress has put up with the overbudget, behind schedule, because SLS has kept the money and jobs flowing to key congressional districts, explains Wendy Whitman Cobb, a professor at the U.S. Air Force's School of Advanced Air and Space Studies. And you can understand why these accusations are being made. For instance, the reusable engines that power SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket cost only $1 million, and Musk is looking to drive down the cost even further to around $250,000. But away from the price issues, the Artemis project has been plagued by several technical issues. So far, the Artemis 1 mission has made two unsuccessful attempts to launch, first on the 29th of August and then on the 3rd of September. NASA stated that fuel leakage problems are responsible for the setbacks, but obviously that's not what the American public want to hear. Over the last few months, NASA has been ridiculed and the credibility of their Apollo program has been questioned many times. On the other hand, though, you've got to understand NASA's decisions to postpone the launch. Space travel is a risky business, and this particular mission is expected to be our farthest trip yet in space, with a total distance of 1.3 million miles. Imagine ruining it with one wrong move. Wouldn't that be much more embarrassing? Yes, we've been to the moon several times in the past, but the SLS is a virgin rocket. And it is also a new era where human lives are valued more than they were during the Cold War age. So there is no real pressure for NASA to hurry up. Also, this mission is much more complicated than the ones we've executed in the past. As for the comparisons between SpaceX and NASA, those are relative. SpaceX is run by an innovative entrepreneur who doesn't have a problem with taking risks and would rather destroy a couple of rockets than postpone the launch. But after the Columbia and Challenger incidents, NASA is much more inclined to prioritize safety more than anything else. And in that light, it's understandable that they've chosen to postpone the launch not once, but twice. I'm not worried about this at all, but in the bigger picture of things, Daniel Dumbacher, one of the executives that oversaw the SLS's initial development, said, "I don't think there's an appreciation for how some of the early decisions that were made and constrained by budget are actually manifesting themselves today," Dumbacher added. At the end of the day, the result is what matters, and so far, NASA hasn't failed with the Artemis mission. Yeah, it's been postponed a couple times, but the reasons for the postponement are legitimate. And even though there will be no human astronauts on board on the first flight, all standard safety protocols must be followed strictly. Furthermore, there's no concrete evidence to suggest that the old RS-25 engines are not efficient enough to power the SLS to the moon. At least not yet. So whether it's a new engine designed by SpaceX or the old RS-25 powertrain, the important thing is for the mission to be accomplished, and so far, everything NASA has done is geared towards achieving it. And rather than blame the space agency, we should hail their resolve to prioritize safety in the face of pressure.